Nevertheless, I hope we all learned something. So I'm here to draw attention to a genre that needs more attention from both music historians and performers. That is late 19th century Catholic liturgical organ music inspired by chant reform. And I mean not organ music, concert music that can be used in the liturgy, mind you, but rather music written for the liturgy and expressly not for the recital hall. I'll discuss one organ mass from 1879 of Franz Liszt, who lived in France and Germany. His life was largely influenced by German Sicilianism in his church music, and two from 1897 of the Frenchman Fanon de la Tombelle, which show a strong contrast in ideals between Sicilianism and Salon reform, Germany and France, and most of all, the passage of two crucial decades of chant reform. So Franz Liszt's Messa pro Organo from 1879 is far more well known than Tombelle's masses, due only to Liszt's great fame, but still among the most widely neglected of all his works, often dismissed as overly simple, or as Michael Sappho writes of Liszt's choral works, similarly, that so grand as to be difficult to listen to. Sometimes. Some of it is very, very simple. Jonas Blumenbach has given great analysis of this mass as a fusion of Liszt's striving for the simplicity of the ideals of the then dominant Sicilian movement with Liszt's own individual, charismatic, and expressive artistic voice, even though, sadly, as Sappho points out, Sicilian leaders, such as Franz Zabel, largely dismissed his religious works. Liszt's mass is clearly intended to accompany low mass, that is, a set mass without any sung music, as demonstrated by the full title, Missa pro organo da tavolo celebrazione di San Adminto Conservius. Further, the movements contain liturgical cues, although sparingly and for little rhyme reasons, such as Agnus Dei, Miserere Nobis during the Gloria, a triple forte, Judicare during the Credo, followed by shortly by Etum Spiritum Sanctum, all of which belong to the movements in question, but those are the only parts of the text that actually get mentioned in the score. And also Ave Maria for the offertory for some reason. This also includes a small optional gradual offertory, which is interesting because neither of those belong to the mass ordinary, such as Kyrie, Gloria, etc., but rather to the mass proper. As this was low mass, though, and there would have been no sung propers or any sung music at all during these points, any music would do to cover these liturgical events. Perhaps this included these extra simple movements for an organist without the ability to improvise. In fact, the registrations, I think they indicate that this may have been intended to be played by a reed organ, by a small little organ, not a big pipe organ. Indeed, this mass is easy enough for an amateur organist to play and could serve a practical purpose in this time for an organist without improvisation skills, especially during an age when the improvisations of such celebrated organists such as Alfred the Favorite were falling out of fashion, seen as silly or lacking religious sincerity. While this mass shows total strength on Liszt's part, unlike most of the music, a deliberate triadic harmony throughout, which Blumenbach and Richard Cohen identify as part of Liszt's attempt to be Sicilian, the colors, registrations, and tempi change enough to give the piece a dramatic Liszt-y flair, even if kind of boring compared to his organ masterworks, which I can't play. Gregorian chant itself, still somewhat in shadow here, features in the incipit of the Gloria, from Mass 4, Pictus Genitor Deus, and the main theme of the Credo, which is from Credo 1. That's basically it, because in this time period, chant is still not well known, so most of the parts of the chant that would have been sung in this time were those parts that the priests would sing to intone those pieces, Gloria and Credo. So that was really the only chant quotation that we'll see, which is in stark contrast to the